So, unser nächster Talk ist
about a smartphone in a lunchbox. And our speaker is Bücherratte. Please have a very warm welcome for her.
Ja, hallo, schön, dass ihr alle da
seid. Hello and welcome.
Erstmal ist es so, dass
First
es
of all,
ja noch andere Talks gibt.
Und there is a lot of other talks. So, well, there is one talk called Hacking is Very Easy. I would have liked to see, but now I'm here. But maybe one of you is interested. Another interesting talk is Conquering Large Numbers, which I think is also very interesting. So maybe you want to go over there. There's still time. And then talk three is Robust, Repairable, Vital Parameter Monitoring. There is a colleague of mine. I think it's very interesting. And talk for the web page in three acts, which is an important performance. And oh no, there are still people in the room. So I guess I'm stuck with this talk. So let's get started.
Who am I?
I am 34 years old. I'm a free software activist. And I work a lot as a volunteer with the Free Software Foundation Europe. I'm active on the board of the Linux User Group in Berlin, and I like hanging out with the user group Linux Works, and I'm very active in that one.
Ich mache zurzeit beruflich ein technisches Jahr.
For work, I do a technical year, and my place where I'm working is the ITDZ, which is a big IT company in Berlin. My dream is to get a VAT training in the IT area. So what is this going to be about? I will tell you about the idea I had, what I started to make and what I fidgeted with. Then there's a little bit about the software and a look into the future, what I'm still planning for this project. And then I will talk a little bit about who helped me with this project, and then it's your turn with Q&As. Let's get to the idea. So I was thinking about a smartphone, that's a nice thing, and the things you can buy in the store, there is maximal tracking installed, and that's not the nicest thing. So what other features are there which I don't really like? There is little control about the software which I can buy in a store. There is little to learn. There are little opportunities to learn about the technical stuff behind the scenes. So what is there to learn besides operating the device? And there is little there's little room to change it around or fidget with it. It's even hard to just change the batteries. So let's be real. It's boring and it's expensive. So it's nothing for people who don't have a lot of money, a lot of spare money. And a big feature against just buying a phone is that WhatsApp is able to be installed, and I don't just want to sell my data to Facebook. I'm not interested in that. An other disadvantage is you're always available. God and the world can just reach you via a lot of different channels. And I don't really want to have this. And for the last point, just everyone has it. Everyone has a phone they bought in a store. So, yeah. So I was looking at what do I need if I build this myself. I need a Raspberry Pi. That's kind of easy. Then next, I need devices to cool it down.
Heatsink to cool it down because the Raspberry Pi 3B produces a lot of heat.
Duscherfraktion now, seid, braucht ihr die nicht.
This can be a bit dicey. If, mir, wenn der Pie kaputt gegangen if you're cool as a cucumber, then you don't need them. But don't complain to me if you break your Raspberry Pi. You're also going to need a touch display. And I opted for the Waveshare 4-inch model. I also tried the 2.8-inch model, but that was way too small, so 4 inches. Now, it also needs a hard drive. I took the micro SD card with 32 gigs. That is mostly okay. You can do a lot of stuff with that. Then you need a cable. You need to connect that thing somehow. But if you're going to build that yourself, don't buy a cable with angled connectors like this. Because if you buy it like this, it'll last forever. If instead you buy the straight connectors, you have to buy new ones every 2 or 3 weeks, which means you can support the economy.
Wichtig ist bei diesem Projekt,
for this project, it's important that you're going to need a headset. Yeah, you could also do that using Bluetooth. At some point I heard a talk saying that it wasn't that safe, so let's go with the cable instead. Then you need power, mobile power. Everyone who owns a smartphone knows that power banks are something really cool, and the more capacity they have, the longer you can play around with them. Then I thought I'll need some sort of case, and I opted to go with a Tupperware container made from plastic, because that it's easily adaptable. And there's a little bit of software that's also missing for the whole recipe. So let's talk about the problems I encountered. From the factory, the Raspberry Pi doesn't have audio in. It has an audio jack with a bit of noise. It's very nice if you want to listen to some music on the train and turn it up way high so you don't hear the noise. But you might need to solder a bit. So there was the option to solder a USB sound card into this. With soldering, beginning can be quite easy. Is not that easy if you start using surface mount devices. I started doing that last year at Congress and didn't know what it was before. But even with bigger pieces, soldering is not that easy. So you should practice a couple of times if you manage to build mountains with your solder. The most difficult thing you can do in terms of soldering is desoldering things. So what I had to do in this case was desolder a USB port. And as you can tell, it's not perfect. I kind of sort of scratched the board a little bit, and I didn't quite do that myself. I had a bit of help because I think on my own I might not have managed. The trick in the end was to use a lot of solder, which is a bit confusing. Now moving on to the case. You can use an acrylic case, but the problem is the touch screen doesn't quite fit. And you're probably going to chip one of the corners and parts and bits and pieces fall off and you're stuck with the Raspberry Pi in your hand. So, no, not quite. So what you can do is use a Tupperware container, which has a lot of advantages. It's really easy to just cut open some parts with a packing knife. One thing you should really avoid, don't do that, do not solder the plastic. If you solder the plastic, you're going to break your soldering iron. It works very well, but you're going to break the soldering iron. All right, so having fixed the Raspberry Pi in the big Tupperware container, that kind of moves around. And what I tried was getting started with eraser gum. And it kind of worked, but the small pieces of gum that came off were rattling around in the box, which wasn't optimal. So what I went for in the end was I used screws and just screwed the Raspberry Pi into the Tupperware container. I used a rainbow kit to get these the right screws to fix it in there, which turned out to be helpful because I was able to fix the USB sound card.
So let's talk about a little bit of software, which actually is just a tiny bit of software. So let's just install it and configure it and have fun. But it turned out to not be quite as easy. You just get into a bunch of problems. It's not as easy as I first would have thought. So let's start at the beginning. I decided against Raspbian. I wanted it to have a little bit more complex to learn something. So I was thinking about Raspbian, and then I would have to deinstall a lot of the software. And I didn't think that was a nice idea because there is a lot of packages and I might not hit all of them. So all the configurations I needed to write myself, and there is like typos you need to make. They are important because this way you sometimes happen along information you otherwise wouldn't have found. This way I managed to configure a right click, which was very nice actually. So there's not all types of software in repositories, and in some cases there is literally nothing. So, for example, for the calendar, that was the case. Because there are calendars for Linux, but there is also touch-able calendars for Linux, but for my project they were too big. Because with the Raspberry, I only have 1 gigabyte of RAM. So you have to think a lot if you want GNOME, for example, because, yeah, rather not, because it's very slow if you are trying to use it. So what I've been saying earlier is the typos. Yeah, you also have to do a lot of research, because, and I think that's a lot of fun, because you get a lot of additional information and you can learn a lot. You are searching for one thing and you find a completely different thing you can use for something else, which is super cool. So with some software, it's the case. There is not only AUR, but in some cases you actually have to compile stuff. And that's actually easy enough to do. It's not that hard. So let's look at the display. That was also an adventure, because the first thing you get the national flag of Friesland, which is great fun if you want to operate some programs on the go. Or the next thing I ran into, when you have the mouse not in the right place as you were touching the screen, it's great if you want to type in a password, and no, there's no way to learn it. So I actually figured it out. This was a configuration which worked for me, and for the options, I used the axis for X and Y, and I just tried random numbers, which ones were going to work, because that's individual for every device. And it's really try and error. You just have to try around. So who of you actually needs a manual? You're all experts, you know? Well, that's what I thought. But the device never read the stupid config file, because I didn't listen to the manual. I didn't take this one step, and this step was essential. I don't know why, But after I copied this file, it actually worked. It read the configuration file. Very nice.
Sorry, kleiner Fehler.
Sorry, it's a mistake.
Dann kann man tatsächlich auch bei anderen abgucken. Andere haben sowas teilweise schon gemacht.
It's actually possible to have a look at what others did. Others actually did similar things.
Dem, was man sich von Rave für das Touch Display runterladen kann, abgeschaut.
And this example I got from WaveShare. From their example documentation for what to do with the touchscreen. And I was able to just copy that down from their examples. That worked really well. It worked. Up until the next update. Damn. And again, I had this wonderful white eagle on a white flag. The problem was that Xorg had installed an update and the FB Turbo driver I was using didn't want to speak to it. Damn. So what I did was switch to the frame buffer driver for the touchscreen, and my feeling was that the resolution improved by a lot. Well, subjective. It seemed more clear, but I'm not sure whether anything changed really. But it worked for me. Now, if you complete a project like this, you might want to enter something while on the road. So you're going to need an on-screen display, on-screen keyboard. Sorry. Most guides will tell you should use a Matchbox keyboard. The problem when using Arch Linux is you can't get that small anymore. So we have a tiny display and a huge keyboard. It's not usable. I found an alternative in the end, XVKBD. And they say it's really hackable. I haven't had a chance to test that yet, but I had a look at the manual and it looks very good. And I can get this to be really small and it fits on the display, so it's very nice. Now, after soldering this USB sound card in there, I also want the device to output the sound using that sound card. I think I searched for 4 days until I got the idea that I could just possibly use the driver that I've been using for the audio jack and just comment that out from the config file. And it worked. Didn't say so anywhere, but it worked. It took me a lot of time to figure that out, but commenting that line out worked. If you're on the road, you probably want to have a possibility for applications, to open applications on the display, like your music player. Now, what you can do is work with a launcher and write desktop files. That's a possibility. You can also just take a dock and I opted for Plank because it's quite slim. It also looks a bit slim on screen here, but it works very well. And I can access the important programs quite quickly. And for me, these important programs are the Document Manager and the Shell. Now you're going to need something to make calls. I did a bit of research and tried a couple things. And
installieren, naja, es gab halt kein
Pacman package. Trying to do Ninfo which wasn't available on Pac-Man, the package manager. There was also a ring, which I found, which was really easy to install. There was one issue. It was too big. And what you see here is a screenshot of an open ring window. And it was a bit difficult to configure that. Because after entering the sign-in data, there's also another tab. But it's impossible to access that tab because the screen is just too small. It's impossible. All right, so I looked for another alternative. Oh, there was another issue. Ring absolutely requires a certificate of the SIP provider. And you have to get that, and you have to find it, and that's not that simple. But you really, really need it, or else Ring doesn't work. And there was another problem. Every time I tried to do anything with the Ring, I did this one touch input, that one tap, and then I could go make a coffee, because it took a long time. So I continued my research and found something called Blink and found a working reasonable package, but wasn't able to get it to compile. So back to Linphone. There is an AUR package, but the package requires 64-bit. Even if I tell it while compiling to use minus A, so ignore the architecture. That didn't work. That the manual for Linphone told me you could use Flatpak, a package for XDG. But that was the error message it threw, because the package is not available for ARM devices. Now, one thing that you should keep in mind for such a project, don't trust any manual you haven't faked yourself.
Ja, es ist ein bisschen blöd. Ich wollte das schon über eine grafische Benutzeroberfläche.
What's possible is to build AUR without the GUI, which is a bit stupid, because I wanted to have a user interface. There was also an option to there is an option to cross-compile the program, and it searches for the GCC cross-compilation option, but I wanted to compile it entirely on the phone, which didn't work. So what I tried as the final step is adding this sys parameter, which tells the system to use the dependencies that are already installed. Because if you don't provide this, then it builds a database that didn't work. It's also important to disable WebRTC, because that just doesn't work on the phone.
Nein, dass andere Abhängigkeiten auch nicht so gut funktionieren.
And other dependencies also aren't working great. In this case, it was the program Minisip, and when I started compiling it, it threw out this error. Imogen.h I couldn't find as a header file. I have no idea about C or C++. I'm a newbie. So I found it on my 64-bit desktop computer. So maybe it's not available for 32-bit. I learned that it is probably because the Raspi has a different configuration, so it isn't available maybe only on the Raspberry Pi. I haven't finished researching this. I found out via GitHub that it's possible
so hinzukriegen, dass es kompiliert,
to figure it out in a way that it can be compiled. So I found the repo of Minisip, and it's a bit more up to date than the one by Linphone, and there was this exclusion which was very nice because when I once I copied it over into the old code, it worked. I deleted the other part and then it worked. It compiled. Very nice. Then I wanted to use SSHX because I'm able to learn. I wanted to use Linphone via forwarding through X, and I tried to configure it, and there was an other error message, and I was like, shit, what's going wrong now? It had been working before, and I was able to use it. So what's wrong here? So I searched for 2 days until I realized that maybe on the Raspberry I should have enabled X forwarding. And yeah, you can just play through that. So that's the other programs I used. I can listen to music, I can surf the net, I can connect to the Wi-Fi, I can look at images, I have a system management for my files, and I can do Jabun via XMTP. So I have, just for fun, I have a screenshot here from the browser. So just so you get an idea how small it actually is once you are trying to use the keyboard. There's a couple of issues. One is I have a zip gate rate, so I have a landline from Berlin. So when I'm on the go and I have great Wi-Fi and when I'm on the go with my smartphone, and if I want to call, let's say, the fire department or the police, it would work, but I would actually end up in Berlin, not here in Leipzig. So that's actually a problem because they just aren't prepared for that. And there's just no solution currently available. Another problem I wasn't able to realize to notice calls if I'm not right now looking at the display or have the headphones plugged in. Graphic configuration, as you've seen earlier on, is kind of difficult. So I actually once had a camera inside, but the display cable broke and for UVC view, the pictures are extremely small and I wasn't able to fix that yet. Look into the future. I want to have a touchable calendar because I need that for myself. I looked at an old phone and I found this one and I was looking for a vibration motor and I found this. And what is it actually? It's a speaker which can vibrate. But even though I looked around a lot, I wasn't able to figure out how to connect to the speaker. If any one of you has experiences with this, that would be nice. I would like to be able to read QR codes, which would be very nice. And as a last step, I want to say thank you to everyone who helped me with this project. So the idea came up helped by Paul Hensch and Sabit Peters. I got a lot of support from LinuxWorks, from the AFRA, which is a hackerspace in Berlin, and also CBase, which is another hackerspace in Berlin, which helped her a lot with soldering. And Thomas helped me a lot with making the pictures and the slides in a way so you could see them nicely. Thank you for listening.
Ja, danke für den super Vortrag. Willst du mir nicht vielleicht dein Telefon mal zeigen?
Ja, klar.
I think that was a great speech. Do you want to actually show your phone? We just on chance have a camera on stage. What you need is the headset, because otherwise it's going to be difficult to actually make a call. So I'm going to connect everything in a way you can use it easily, and then I'm going to call you from my decked phone.
Sounds good.
Ich gebe das Passwort ein.
Ah. Oh.
I'm right now typing in my password, so I would rather not have everyone see that.
All right, you can try.
Du hast mich jetzt auch tatsächlich geschafft, nicht durcheinander zu bringen. Das ist,
you managed to not confuse me, because the first try, it actually worked. There's a moment of intense suspense going on here. Ja. Let's hope the Wi-Fi is working. Yeah, it looks good.
Ich würde dich jetzt einfach bitten, mal die
Kopfhörer. I would like to ask you to put on the headphones.
Geht es?
Does it work?
Okay, yeah.
Und dann rufe ich dich jetzt einfach mal an.
I'm just going to call you.
Ja, es geht.
Yes, it's working.
Ich glaube nicht, dass das den EU-Richtlinien zur Maximallautstärke.
I don't think this is in line with the EU guidance for maximum volume.
Gut, möchtest du sonst noch was zeigen oder sollen wir lieber zu den Fragen?
All right. Would you like to show something else or should we move on to Q&A?
Gut, ihr kennt das Spiel. Wir haben Saalmikrofone, vier an der Zahl. All
right, so you know the game. There's microphones in the room. Please walk up to them. And if you're on the internet, please ask your questions via IRC or Twitter.
Sorry, Deutscher Talk.
Yeah, we are doing the translation into English here, and the signal angel almost started asking the question in English. So the question came up if you have thought about to use a setup for a SIM card with a UNTS module instead of SIP gate.
Yes, I consider that, but for me, the aspect was that GSM isn't really free. We don't really know what it does, according to what I heard. And I then considered using a UMTS USB stick and then using SIP. But on such short notice before Congress, I wasn't able to implement that.
Was there a person at microphone 3? The person sat back down? Anyone else? Another question from the internet? There is one person coming up.
So, zwei bitte.
Hi.
Hello.
Wenn du Angst vor,
if you're afraid about software which isn't free, why do you use Raspi? If there is a thing you need to boot it up, where we aren't actually in full information what it can do.
Yes, you're right, of course. For my main consideration was that I didn't want to make things too difficult. It was already quite difficult to put all of this together. The project isn't done yet, and I'm still considering using another single platform PC, but I'm not there yet.
So a Raspberry Pi needs a lot of energy, especially for the display. Did you build in anything that it goes into standby automatically, and how long does a power bank last?
So the power bank I have now lasts about 2 days, which is quite nice. I didn't toy around with it, really, no. The Raspberry Pi 3B Plus uses too much power for the power bank. I tried that, didn't work. But the 3B that I'm using works quite well. I also thought whether using something like ACPI could let me check the charge level of a power bank. but couldn't find anything.
So it's still more battery life than my iPhone, so you're good.
Einmal die Eins, bitte.
Microphone number one. Thank you for the talk. My question is, are you able to charge the device while you're using it?
That depends on the power bank. If the power bank can do pass through, so this quick charge functionality, then it's possible. If it can't, then no.
Any other questions? We still have a bit of time, like 4 minutes and a couple of seconds.
Oder vielleicht das Internet noch.
Also, people on the internet, feel free to ask a question via Twitter or IRC. The internet doesn't have a question. Microphone number one. Thank you for this talk. You said you didn't use GSM or something like that. It's a bit off topic, but related. At my ThinkPad, I have a UNTS stick and I can get SMS, and I was thinking if there is an option to get calls, and maybe you stumbled upon this with your research. Otherwise, anyone else in the room, how you can use a desktop to make a call?
That's exactly what I did using the SIP phone.
Do you know about any software to get in touch with a net?
I didn't look into that further, sorry.
Well, thanks. Any answer from the audience?
Jemand sagt, es gibt es. Das ist ja schon mal gut.
Someone shouted in, yes, it's possible, so that's good news. There is one more question. By an angel. So if I was thinking, if no one else has a question, I'm going forward. Have you been thinking about instead of USB for sound, do you something else?
Yeah. But then the whole project would have been even bigger. It's already quite thick, and it would no.
Gut, dann bitte noch einen großen Applaus.
So a huge round of applause.